Good morning everyone and welcome to a new video about Xamarin. In this video I will show how to create a simple Xamarin Android application, and I will also provide information about the basic concepts that you need to know when building any application for the Android platform. Here I have Visual Studio 2017 open, and the first thing I'm going to do is opening the new project dialog. Then I will select the Android templates folder. I'm going to select the single view app Android project template. This provides me with a basic infrastructure and some startup code that is ready to use. For all the other project templates and for all the other topics and advanced concepts that I will not discuss in this video, please refer to the documentation at developer.xamarin.com. Let me call this project as send email Android. Okay. Let's wait for Visual Studio to generate the project. Here you will be presented with a welcome page. Let's open Solution Explorer. And let's start understanding how a Xamarin Android project is made. Let's close the properties window for a while. In Solution Explorer, you will find a number of important files and folders. The first important file is called the mainactivity.cs, and this is actually the main entry point. An activity is a very important concept in the Android development. It represents an object that allows a user to interact with the device through some user interface. An activity could be compared to a page that contains a series of visual elements and altogether allow to execute a specific task. Xamarin Android provides a class called Activity, which is a base class and therefore it cannot be used directly, and is exposed by the Android.app namespace. In the code editor in Visual Studio 2017, but also in previous versions, you will see typical C# elements such as using directives for namespace that are specific to the Android APIs, and that you can easily recognize because their namespace starts with the Android literal. I will explain how to write the code for an activity shortly. Let me now explain other important files and folders that are inside the Xamarin Android project. The assets folder contains a txt with some useful information. Resources is much more important. It contains a drawable subfolder where you will place all the icons and all the image files that your app will need. And it's important for you to know that you will need to create multiple folders depending on how many resolutions you want to support. By the way, the drawable subfolder will contain the lowest resolution possible for each of the images you want to use in your application. The layout subfolder contains the user interface definitions for all of your pages and visual elements. Values is another folder that contains a string.xml file. This file contains a list of strings that are mapped to visual elements and that you can use for localization. Let's double click the main.axml file. As you can see, Visual Studio will show a designer, and here you can design the user interface exactly as you would do with any other kind of applications you built with Visual Studio. You have a toolbox where you can find all the user controls that are available to Xamarin Android. In Android, the name of controls is typically widget. So let's start by drawing some of the user interface that we need. The goal of the sample application is allowing a user to send an email. So we certainly need a label, which is called text view. I can drag it here, and then with the properties window that I open by pressing F4, I can go and change the default value for the text. Let me scroll. All right. Here I can write the new text, for example, enter recipient. For each widget you add to the user interface, you will also find an ID property. This is very important because it basically represents the name for a widget. So I can change this into recipient label. Notice that this prefix with ID must not be changed. This is required by Android to easily recognize and map UI elements. Okay. Then I can go down and scroll the toolbox and I can find a number of text fields. These text fields allow the user to enter some text, and for each text field, the operating system will display the proper keyboard. In our case, we could select the email text field. In this way, every time the user taps into this text box, Android will show the proper keyboard to enter an email address. Then I can add another label that will be this kind of text. And for example, I can change the text property and enter subject. Then I can place another text field. In this case, plain text is fine. I can change the ID. For example, with subject text. I will also need to change the ID for the previous box, such as recipient name. And finally, I will add another label. I can change the text property with enter email body. And then I can add a plain text field. I need to change the ID because I will need to interact with this field in C# code in a few. So I can call it email body text. While we are in the designer view, you can see how you can select a different device to understand how the user interface would appear at design time on a different form factor. You can change the API level for your Android application. In this case, I only have Android 6. The API level will allow you to select a different target version of the Android operating system. You can also switch between themes, you can change the design view orientation, and you can also use the zoom. Now, let's see how this user interface is made. I can right-click the main.axml file and then select view code. As you can see, there is the XML definition for the user interface. This is exactly the same definition that Android Studio generates. So you could potentially copy and paste your XML definition for the user interface between Visual Studio, Xamarin Studio, and Android Studio. Now let's go back to the mainactivity.cs file and let's write some C# code. Okay. Every activity has an onCreate method that is raised when the activity starts. So, the base onCreate method provides all the plumbing infrastructure. SetContentView establishes what is the user interface that is associated to the current activity, in this case, the main page that we designed before, and that is easily associated through a resource identifier that Visual Studio generates every time you add a new UI element. Next, you have to retrieve an instance of each controller you want to interact to by C# code. And this can be done using a method called findViewById, which is a generic method. As you can see, there are a number of concepts that you already know as a C# developer, such as generics. So in my case, I need to retrieve the instance of the text fields for the recipient, the subject, and the email body. So I can retrieve those instances by declaring some variables of type edit text, recipient name equals find view by ID of edit text resource dot ID dot subject text. Recipient name. Okay. Then edit text subject equals find view by ID of edit text resource ID dot subject text. Finally, edit text email body equals find view by ID of edit text resource dot ID dot email body text. Here you can see an event handler for the click on a button. It doesn't make much sense talking about clicks on a mobile device, but this is how events are implemented. So a click occurs when a user touches a UI element. In this case, I can write the code to send an email here, and to do this, I need to introduce a new concept, which is the concept of intent. An intent may be thought of as a single task that the user can perform, and which is represented by a class called intent. An intent also requires an object, including an external application, that can perform the task. So I can start writing var email equals new intent. There are different kinds of intents in Xamarin.Android. In this case, if I use IntelliSense with the intent type, I will see the list, the full list of all the available intents. In my case, what I need is action send. Okay. At this point, email is a variable of type intent. I can call on this variable a method called putExtra, which allows me to specify all the properties for my email. The first property is, of course, the recipient, which can be specified by writing intent.extra email. Okay. And then I need to pass a string array that contains the list of recipients that will receive the email. In my case, I have just one recipient, which is available through the recipient name dot text property. Then I can specify the subject, email dot put extra, intent dot extra. Okay. Intent dot extra subject, and the text of the subject here is specified inside the subject dot text property. Finally, I can specify the email body with the put extra method again, passing intent dot extra text. And the mail body, which is inside the email body.text property. One last step is setting up the email format, which is done by calling set type and passing a string which is message slash RFC 822. At this point, I can start an activity for this intent. This can be done by calling start activity and then passing the intent instance. In this case, by calling start activity, the Android operating system will show a list of possible applications that can run this activity on your device. Before running the application, let's take a look at the project properties. In the application tab, you can specify the SDK versions you want to use to compile the application and the minimum target version. More important is the Android manifest. Not only here you can specify the application name and you can supply an application icon, but also you can specify and you must specify the required permissions for your application. Here is a full list, but in our case, the permission we certainly need is called Internet. If you do not specify these permissions, your application will crash. You have additional options in the Android options tab. For example, you can control some of the compilation options. When you build an Android application, this is a general concept, not just a Xamarin Android concept, the compiler generates an APK package. This is the package for your application. Let me give you one suggestion. Remove the use fast deployment flag. This is because the build process will refresh all the files on either your device or an emulator. Okay, let's try to run the sample application at this point. In the toolbar, you will see the available devices for debugging and testing. In this particular moment, I can show only emulators, but if I plug my Android device into the USB port of my machine, this will be immediately recognized by Visual Studio. I have the Visual Studio emulator for Android here, but you can use whatever emulator you want. So let's start the application. Okay. So, as you can see, the application is running inside the emulator. I can write some text here. For example, I could write an email address here. I could enter a subject. And the email body. When I click, as you can see, the email application that is configured on my device will be able to perform the task defined inside my intent. If I had multiple email clients, then Android would ask me which to choose to perform this task. So in summary, in this video, we have seen how to create a Xamarin Android project. We have seen the structure of the project, and we have seen how to set properties of the project with the properties window. We have seen how to design the user interface using the tools, the integrated tools in Visual Studio. We have seen how to write C# code to create an intent, in this case, an intent for sending an email. Then we have seen how to write C# code to start an activity. After this, we have seen how to set permissions in the application manifest, and we have seen how to select the target device for debugging and testing the application, in this particular case, an Android emulator. You will be also able to use the full debugging instrumentation that Visual Studio has always offered. Thank you so much for watching this video.